they built more lesser, smaller spaces and created something which can earn them more profits. So people believed that, oh, this is the only space that exists for me, let me buy that. They bought it, and then they spent lakhs and lakhs of rupees to make it interesting now, according to their taste. That is called interiors. So interiors was done, interiors is done. We also are part of it, we do interiors and make people believe that this is their beautiful home. But what is a beautiful home? See, it all started with my mom and dad wanting to plant some trees, grow their own vegetables. They were always fond of farming. So when we came here, it's a typical Telangana arid kind of terrain. No trees, as you can see. It was very hot. So we basically needed some shelter that can help them to do this activity. Shelter from rain. So that's the basic way anyone would start their housing. So that's where the thought of Aalaya started with. And we started exploring what spaces do we need, what are the requirements that we have. So one by one we started it, and me being the architect in the house, so somewhere I think I was responsible to draft these things. Aalaya has a meaning, you know. Aalaya means a house, you know, in our Indian, any language that you see. That's how we come with Himalaya or Shabdalaya or whatever. So Aalaya, it was really exciting for us as a name. And Aalaya in Arabic term is greatness. So I somehow thought that, you know, exploring about housing, which I always wanted to do during college as I was a student of architecture, exploring about spaces and understanding what spaces do we need, as you know, for us as humans, was something which was very exciting. So Aalaya as a name became like a, you know, something that we would want to do it here. So initially we wanted one, my mom or my wife or anyone, men usually have this nature to, you know, to do urinate, but we don't encourage it. But yeah, but women need sanitation, basic sanitation facilities. So my basic thing was to provide a toilet. And when we used to come here to plant trees, we needed some tools and equipment. So we need a storage. So these are two basic essential things that I thought Aalaya should start with. So one is the toilet and other one is the storage room. And then we wanted a basic veranda where people can sit and watch the, you know, do their work or watch the work happening. So that's where the basic first functionalities came in: a veranda, a toilet and a stove. Now, we or my dad needed something with tea. Chai, which we can't do away with. So the kitchen was something again which was important. As we were working, we wanted a kitchen. So a kitchen came into being. Then we want water, and it should be cold. So then the refrigeration should happen. So the refrigerator came. So these are how one by one the functions started increasing. And then we thought, okay, well, one of the persons working, and if we're tired, we want to sleep or to rest. So we can sleep in the veranda, but what if there are mosquitoes, or we want to just, if it's too hot and we want to sleep inside. So that's where the, we wanted to have a bed inside. So so that's how we drafted these requirements of, you know, be having a bed, having a kitchen, having a veranda to sit outside, enjoying the landscape. And one of the most important thing that featured in everyone's to-do list was a water pond. So the water pond or the lotus pond that we have right now, was in everybody's list. So that was something that was non-negotiable. So that kind of created a focal point for me. I thought the wind or the air that flows through this water can really give us a nice cool weather, cool breeze for the people who are sitting here. So that's how the water pond came. So I would say that Aalaya was formed because people charted out their requirements and they knew exactly what they wanted, and we built this space. If I remember, I very strongly remember about this one thing, that you know, when I was born in a Gandhi ashram, and I used to remember that Gandhi used to have a small platform which was just 6 inches above where, you know, people would move. It's part of the living room, and his entire house used to be like a studio apartment. If you go to Wardha, and it's, the place still exists, the entire space used to be like a studio apartment with a small step up, and he used to sit there, and if he just moves there, there would be a loo, and he would clean his own loo, and there would be a small library, and if people came from outside to visit him, there used to be one small attic that he did it with bamboos, and he used to keep it on top of that. As a kid, I was very fascinated about this space, that you know, Gandhi in those times, and it all used to be that earthy mud look, you know, monochromatic that people today call about design, and the palettes that he used to use of nature, of you know how things used to be done. It might seem as if it just came to him, but if it was coming to him like that, then all the houses should be like that, right? But today we don't see such houses. So that was very fascinating, and as we moved forward, my mom and dad, when they created their house in Alkapuri, it was all of what, 1100-1200 SFT of carpet area, with their basic earnings from the state government employees being the, you know, basic salaries, and you know, paying our fees, school fees and all that, still they came up with a house which was just about 1200 odd SFT. Still, that largeness of space, I'm still yet to find it, you know. Though I today live in a 5000 square feet villa, I'm still amazed at the space that we have in Alkapuri. The way we sit out and enjoy our evenings, it is large. And I think somewhere Aalaya was trying to find it. It was not about the how big the SFT is, how much more the SFT is, but how much more by heart you can fit in. So I think, yeah. So idantha kattadaniki, when we started this house, the main thing was about keeping the cost low. So when we come so far and we have a small space, so generally a house requirements came out nante, we generally tend to spend a lot. Ekku kharche ipoyi tarvata manam, do we require so much ani manam general anukunta untam. So when we started this space, the cost of construction was supposed to be low. So how do we bring keep the costs in control? Was that first thing was how materials. So the most of the materials that you find in Aalaya are being fetched in and around from this place. Most importantly, the stone that is used for the walls. The stone that you use for the walls is actually something that we find here. So right in the, you know, in this field, we kind of fetched all the stones, and that becomes the walls of this building. Next, the flooring of the space is tandoor, and tandoor is just the next stop from Chevella. So that's again something which is almost about 40-50 kilometers from here. We just fetch that kind of flooring. So and then when we thought of getting the house, the transportation is something that will become very high. So if you get something from Hyderabad, the transportation, everything, and people coming here. Importantly, when we're doing this this lotus pond, the feature of water and the sound of water is very important for any architectural piece. So being a small space, money constraints lo cheyali, economical ga cheyali ani anukunna kuda, water feature gaani, like with the landscape elements, small tree, like this tree in the middle of water. So when it's interesting, because when I designed this water body, and I was thinking of a temple tree somewhere in the background. But then Supriya, my wife, she said, why not have the tree in the middle of that water? Can we have it as an island? So having something as an island is something as an imagery that people have. And immediately that translates into a space. So this is something that I find it very fascinating that, you know, as humans, we have some memory and we try to subconsciously create it somewhere. And as architects, we're constantly searching for it. So this tree happened because of that. And the way the veranda and everything was designed also was done with basic bare amenities. Like the frontage of this building is about 20 feet. So it's quite wide. So you have space for people to have a nice glass window where you can sit inside and you know, you can have the view of the terrain. But while you go inside and when you're reaching to the end of the space, it just narrows down to being 10 feet. Furthermore, it becomes 6 feet. So why I'd use that trapezoidal or a hexagonal form is that it reduces the wall area for me. It kind of brought down the material cost for me. So these are few things which at the same time we did not compromise on the aesthetics. If you see the building from as you enter, the way it slopes and the entire roofing slopes down in one form was ideally done so that we can make the building look larger than what it is. So it's a building which is basically a 300 square feet of space. I never in my mind tried to make it look small. It was something which is large, big, with all the amenities that it had, that a normal house would have. Yes, it is done with an intention to have an open plan, because this is a farmhouse and we didn't want to have farm cottage. And basically we come here for this, basically planting trees, enjoying the nature, sitting outside, and you know, having the dogs to just run around, and easy to maintain. So when we designed, I didn't want to design rooms because it would become difficult to maintain it. I usually come down here and start opening the doors and cleaning the house. So it takes me about 5 minutes. So this is how basically everybody should probably plan their cottages, easy to maintain. There'll be rodents, there'll be insects, there'll be so many things. So you basically have to fight all that. And see, what happens is when we go around the villages. This village is Nyalata, Pakkan Duddagu undi, and we cross a lot of villages. And when we go through these villages, and when we were actually renting out some spaces while we were constructing this thing, the spaces were so good. You know, in fact, when we enter, there'll be a small veranda. There'll be a space where, you know, there's a way they cut the light. They have the small spaces. They will have a small bedroom. And that will be overlooking a small, you know, pond, which are still existing. And but they have left those spaces. They are right now living in. I have heard that in fact one of them is a barber, and he has moved to a house in the town, and in the city in Hyderabad, and he lives in a flat. I'm wondering that, you know, when we look at these houses, and we can learn so much from their architecture, their genius of how they utilize light and ventilation, and why we are not able to do it. I think we have to all probably learn about these things, create a sense of awareness of what are the spaces that we need for ourselves, for our kids, for our parents, and then one by one, step by step, create this thing. So what I would arrive at is that if you want something like this to be done for yourself, first list down your requirements, and then probably identify an architect who would represent you, an architect who would be aware of such things, a small part of you should be in the architect and how he represents you. And then you tell him his requirements and see how he he would come out with an outcome of the spaces for you. So that's one thing that I would advise. Yeah. So in spaces like this, affordability is one of the primary goal for any client. And affordability, especially when you're building in spaces like this, where you know, materials will be very difficult to be found. It's always important to look around. It's like this building, when we were about to build the walls, we looked at various options. Like we looked at brick, we looked at precast things, and then cement boards and all that. But then we looked around and we said, when we have supposed to transport all that, it was taking a lot of lot of money. So then we just looked around, and what we found was the stone. The stone that you see all in these walls is all brought from the land that we are sitting right now. And it's free of cost and it's part of nature. And today when we sit inside, the kind of weather control that it does is brilliant, and at the same time it's cost effective. And the kind of texture that it gives is something that would give a run for the money for any material that you would find in the world. Another thing that we did was using Mangalore tiles. So tiles is something that always fascinated me. I've used it in Rajgarh Tota. I've used it in another farmhouse that I've done. And the roofing, if you see the Mangalore tiles, it allows the building to breathe. So because of the pores that it has, and hot air rises up, you'll always have the building to breathe. So the hot air rises up and it always is, it flows away from this building. So the cold air is again seeping in from inside the windows. So this kind of a play of air is something that we would be able to achieve if you're using materials which are breathing. So this is something that I really found that we all should do. So basically here, the sofa cum bed, this study table, and that sofa, all these three things can be doubled up as a different space altogether. So one of it is this one. So all this is available in IKEA. You can get it anywhere. I basically believe that, you know, you can find it anywhere in ready-made shop. Just get it. There's nothing called interiors that you can find a space and fill it up with whatever you like. So this is something that we found in IKEA, and I think really helped us. And so this was all assembled also. So this is brought in boxes in my car. So transportation was minimal because we could transport everything. That's the best thing when we find modular furniture. So this is all part that was bought in the car. We assembled everything here and we have it here. So this one doubles up as a dining table. So in total, about five people can sit, six people can sit, and during a lunch time, usually during the farm work is happening and we have lunch, six people can conveniently sit here and have lunch. And once it's done, and this also got drawers. I mean, there are different types of things actually. In IKEA, we get furnitures which are, well, but we like this because in a space like this, we will definitely need a lot of storage. So it really helped us getting this furniture, having a lot of drawers. So all the spoons and cutlery goes into that. And then there's this one where I created this one, which this is again assembled right here. And we have drawers. I didn't want a closed box because already the space is low. So we didn't want anything that is going to be closed box and not allowing us to see the other side. So, ideally, something like this should cost you around 8 lakhs for the structure. If you look at the landscape, furniture, or architecture fees, or the conveyance if it's out of city, then all that you should put aside about 4 lakhs for the architecture fees or something like that. So something like this should come to you around 12 lakhs. That should be the ideal figure. The sky's the limit. You can do wardrobes, you can do fantastic furniture, and you know, the prices can shoot up. But 12 lakhs should be an ideal budget for something like this.